This is Mary Jo Deschanel, and we're listening to Twin Peaks Unwrapped.
Welcome to Twin Peaks Unwrapped. I'm your host, Ben Durant, and beside me is...
Across the internet, Bryon Kazaska.
Hey, Bryon. How are you?
Doing good, Ben. I'm recording this in my kitchen while you're recording this at your home.
Yep, in my office.
In your office. You know, we're in the middle of a pandemic.
The coronavirus.
Yeah, and this is like one of the first shows we're recording because of this.
I know, and we finally caught up with, you know, we record shows, we usually stockpile our shows. We've always done that since the beginning. And this is our first one where we kind of caught up to the real world. And we got to find new ways to actually do the show.
Yeah, the show must go on for the community and for our sanity. I look forward to doing the show with Ben every week, and you know it's maddening to be stuck inside, but then having no one really to talk to and talk Twin Peaks is even crazier. It's been fantastic that we can do this, and also with Graceland being postponed, we had our mini Graceland not that long ago from home. You know, we did a Twin Peaks event on Friday.
Yeah, we're starting this new thing where we're using KAST. Where we can actually share shows. So we have like a private chat room where you can actually share episodes of Twin Peaks. And we started off with a pilot to celebrate the 30th anniversary. And that's so much fun. I mean, that is so cool to get everybody together virtually.
Yeah, and that's something we hope to continue every Friday. We'll keep everyone posted on social media. It's a lot of fun. And Scott Ryan did an amazing job with Blue Rose Magazine. Did a huge panel, which was fantastic.
That Saturday. Yeah,
yeah. We had our mini Graceland at home, which was really awesome.
Bryon, our book is out now. You can get it at Blue Rose Mag. You can get the Kindle edition on Amazon, and I'm so excited that everybody now, I mean, there were some people that, you know, the shipping was way too expensive to go to ship overseas. So now they can pick it up through Kindle and read the digital copy. And it's so exciting that that's available to everybody now.
Right. And the Kindle version has color photos, which is so cool.
Yes. That's so cool. There is also, I just love, I mean, I have a habit of buying both, a lot of times, books twice. I just love having it on me. I love having it on my phone where I can check it out wherever I want to. And I feel like I'm getting old because sometimes I like too that I can see it on my computer and I can, it's bigger. It's just right. Bigger. So it's nice. Right. But you know, what we want to do is every once in a while, maybe share an interview that was actually that we did for the book. And I thought that's what we would do today where, you know, we're not going to do every single interview that's in the book, but I thought it'd be a great way for people who get a sample of what some of the interviews are like in the book. And that's what we want to do today with Mary Jo Deschanel.
Right. She is a talker. She was a great sport, and it was actually an honor to get to speak to her in person. She's an amazing person. And when you listen to this podcast, you can just hear the enthusiasm and the love and such a kind person just radiate through your speakers. It's like, it's infectious. She just puts you in a great mood, you know?
Totally. And I'd love to share how this interview came about. I mean, like, you know, we were really trying to get everybody that was in Twin Peaks in the book. Like, so we reached out to everybody. But then I think We also enjoy finding quirky, kind of strange ways of getting other people to be involved to contribute. So actually, you know, looking for like contacting reps, yeah, Mary Jo was not available. I could not find a contact. We couldn't find any way of reaching out to her. But Zoe Deschanel, I could reach out to the rep for Zoe Deschanel, which is Mary Jo's daughter, who, you know, is in New Girl and all that. And she had actually done an interview on Jimmy Kimmel's show. And she mentioned that when she was little, she actually was on the set of Twin Peaks. And so, boy, I thought, wouldn't that be cool to just see if she would contribute to the book to talk about her own experiencing as a young girl seeing Twin Peaks.
And Stitches.
Your parents were both in show business.
Yes.
Your mom was on
Twin Peaks.
Twin Peaks,
yes.
Yeah.
And my dad directed a bunch of episodes
of Twin Peaks.
So they were both working on it when I was but a wee child. And I would go to visit the set, but I was only allowed to watch some of the episodes because... Yeah. It's
weird.
Not appropriate for children, but that's the type of show that's extremely addictive. If you know that show, it's really, you know, you have to, it's like a soap opera.
You can't just watch a little
you
of it.
You have to watch it. So I remember I would try to sneak and watch the episodes I wasn't allowed to watch.
And so we reached out, and the rep wasn't interested in really Zoe being a part of it. I think she was too little to really have anything to say about it. But they did say, hey, did you reach out to her mom and dad, which is, you know, Mary Jo, who played Mrs. Hayward, and then Caleb Deschanel directed some of the episodes. And so both Mary Jo and Caleb, there was no way to reach out to them. So actually, Zoe Deschanel's rep said, hey, I'll reach out to Mary Jo and see if you can get an interview. The funny thing is that, you know, having this doing this interview with Mary Jo, that led to her saying she would reach out to Caleb. So we also got to talk to Caleb about Twin Peaks as well. So it's funny to start off with Zoe being interested in seeing if Zoe would participate, to then having her mom and dad actually be able to do interviews with them.
Right. It's awesome. I mean, Ben, you made magic happen getting these interviews.
I would say we. I try very hard. I'm like Mark Frost. I don't want to take all the credit. I want to like say that.
I give you all the credit. I give you all the credit for getting these interviews. You did it. So you deserve all the credit. But yeah, so everybody, please enjoy Mary Jo Deschanel. And if you like what you hear today and you like to support us, it's a limited supply. Go to bluerosemag.com. Get yourself a copy. And if you want a digital version, it's on Kindle for $10. Just search Twin Peaks Unwrapped. And here's Mary Jo.
Good. How are you?
Great.
Good.
How did you get the part of Eileen Hayward?
Well, you know, Caleb, my husband, went to the AFI with David.
Ah.
So I met him, you know, because that was the first year of the AFI.
Yeah.
So there were 15 fellows. There was no curriculum. I don't know if you know any of this about the AFI first year, but the first couple of years.
No, and it's interesting. I think Tim Hunter, there's a few directors that were part of AFI, and I wondered, and they seem to have known David.
Caleb and David and Terrence Malick and Tom Rickman, Gil Dennis. There are a lot of other people. I'm not remembering everybody, but there were a lot of people. But the curriculum was they would order films. And drink hot chocolate and coffee. And, you know, I was up there a lot hanging out watching movies with them. I mean, it wasn't like there were no classes.
Wow.
People, you know, directors would come and give lectures, but, you know, it was at the old Greystone Mansion, and it was just, you know, very casual kind of like, you know, at that moment. And then everybody was working on films. And so David was working on Eraserhead at that time. And so I knew him. I mean, I knew, you know, everybody there, I think. And we would also have a lot of, it's hard to imagine, I guess, probably now for people. But, you know, we had dinners all back and forth at people's houses because, you know, it was really hard to get a credit card. People didn't go out to eat that much.
Yeah.
So we had these dinners with all these, you know, I mean, it was because my husband had gone to, you know, USC before that. So, you know, it was, you know, all the young filmmakers at that time. And we would just go to each other's little, you know, houses or apartments, and we'd have dinners back and forth. So I saw David, you know, there were social dinners. I remember going to his house and then going to, you know, Matthew Robbins and just seeing him. And so I knew him from that period of time. And then when he was doing Twin Peaks, well, I just got a call from my agent, and it was just a meeting. You know, there was no casting per se. Like, I mean, casting in the sense of an audition. Yeah. There's no audition. But, you know, I'd already done work. I guess he knew my work. And I think also the way I looked was probably quite right for the part.
Totally.
My coloring, you know, is the, and then, you know, one of the main things that I had done to that point was The Right Stuff. And, you know, I played Annie Glenn, who had a bad stutter. And so I think, you know, I seemed to do well playing someone with some kind of disability. I don't know why he chose me. I mean, I just went and talked to him. I just went and met him.
Yeah.
And then I got the part. It wasn't like, oh, you know, there wasn't some, you know, there was never revealed to me for any reason, but that's what I assume, you know. Mm, just was right for it, and very few people do that. And that's one of the things I really admire about David, is that, you know, he can just have a meeting with someone and cast them.
That is something.
Yeah, that's what he does.
Right. I think just having a conversation, just having a conversation, you get to know who that person is. That's something.
Yeah. And, you know, as I said, I did know him before that, not really well, but, you know, I certainly knew him. But Billy Friedkin does the same thing. He just meets people. He doesn't audition.
Isn't that something? Wow.
Wow.
Just a little trivia, I guess, but,
I like the trivia. I guess I even want to tiny bit more that. So the AFI, was it like the mid 70s then? You guys were probably hanging out a little bit.
Well, it's the early 70s. It was, okay. I think it was like, I don't know. You'd have to look. The first year of the AFI was maybe 71 or 70. I don't know.
Wow.
Something like that. No, it was the early 70s. I mean, not that it was easy now. I mean, like for my husband, you know, I mean, it's very hard, of course, to, you know, be a filmmaker now. But at that time, you know, to become a cinematographer, you know, that you had to sue to get into the union.
Wow.
You had to have a lawsuit. And everybody had a lawsuit to get in.
Oh, my gosh.
And it would take years because you couldn't. It was a closed shop, the IA.
Wow.
At that time. So, you know, so you think, oh, well, it wasn't that it was easy. It's just more like how people thought of it. So I think now there's so many people and there's a lot of competition, but at the same time, there's a lot more material now. I mean, with so many, you know, it's so much material right now and so many projects. So I guess there's more opportunity that way, even though there are, you know, more people, but I don't know whether it's easy or harder really, you know, just
totally.
You
know. Mm. Yeah. So Mrs. Hayward was in a wheelchair, but you're able to walk. What was it like for you having to be in a wheelchair for every scene of the show?
Oh, well, you know, I don't think I really cared about much in terms of a contract or something, but I said I wanted a wheelchair to practice with, you know, to practice with at my house. So there was a really funny incident. So I had the wheelchair in the house. And I just went, you know, I was kind of, would get in it and kind of be in it, you know, just to practice how to, you know, maneuver the electric wheelchair, because I didn't want to, you know, not know how to do it, obviously. Right. So one day, I don't know, my kids were, you know, they weren't small, but they weren't, you know, that old, you know, children at home. And it was kind of a crazy household, lots of things always going on in and out, you know, in the house, and a lot of people coming in and out and all that kind of thing. And I remember one time I was in the wheelchair and some people came in. I don't know why they were there, but it wasn't someone I knew and they didn't know me. And I was in the wheelchair and they said hello. And I didn't think anything of it. And then at some point, you know, I got up out of the wheelchair to go do something, and the look on their faces, they just thought, you know, and I was in a wheelchair, but no.
It's amazing. She can walk.
She can walk.
Yeah. But I don't know. I felt very comfortable. I guess I felt very comfortable to me. I remember, though, one thing that was sort of difficult was that, you know, I could never know the backstory of why I was in the wheelchair.
Hmm.
Because I remember asking about it, and it was like they just laughed and said, well, we have so many different scenarios that are possible.
Yeah.
So it was kind of revealed, you know, later. But, you know, I sort of had to have in my mind, you know, as an actor, you sort of have to have your own, you know, story. But I sort of had to have it a little bit loose and almost like someone maybe with a faulty memory or not knowing exactly what happened, because it could have been completely psychosomatic. It could have been, you know, I didn't know what it was because they didn't know. They had many ideas, but they didn't know which way they were going to go. So, but it was, I, you know, I didn't feel that it was, it just felt like that was who she was, you know?
Right. Yeah.
I don't remember it being difficult in the sense of being in a wheelchair, just what it was, you know?
I was rewatching your scenes today, and what I noticed was, like, Warren Frost, you know, Doc Hayward would have to bend down to do a scene with you, or even Donna would have to bend down. And I think, like, how uncomfortable was that for an actor that you're used to standing eye to eye and being up, and everybody's always having to, like, crouch down to do the scene with you?
That's so funny. I never thought of that. But then I also think, well, I'm not that tall to begin with, so, you know, and it's funny. You know, my husband did this film with Florian von Donnersmarck, Never Look Away. I don't know if you know about that film.
No,
but he's almost 7 feet tall. Oh, it's an amazing film.
Wow.
It's so great. It was nominated for Best Foreign Language Film, and Caleb was nominated for Cinematography. It's about the creative process, and it's inspired by Gerhard Richter. I mean, you should really see the film.
Yeah, definitely.
It's so good. It's really an amazing film. I know I'm prejudiced, but I'm not in it or anything. But anyway, Florian, he won an Oscar for The Lives of Others about 10 years ago. He's German, and it was in German. But anyway, he's almost 7 feet tall. And we spend a lot of time with them, you know, in the last couple of years. And all their children, everybody's so tall. And it's so funny, you know, because I say when I see, you know, when I see Florian, I say, you know, it's like you're different species, you know, that, you know, like how can people be so different and still, you know, in terms of just size. So, I mean, I wonder too if, you know, I didn't even think about that, that people had to crouch down. That's really funny that wasn't in my, I just thought I was, I don't think I thought of myself as being in a wheelchair. Now that when you bring it up.
Yeah.
I don't think that was, it was just like that was my reality.
Huh. Mm. Isn't that something? That's
really something. Yeah. So I'm glad you brought it up. And that gives me something to think about.
Yeah.
That I hadn't thought about before.
Totally.
You know?
And so as the cast grew in season two, some of the original cast seemed to have less parts, but your character grew with the storyline and like kind of like the whole Donna's father storyline. How did you feel about getting a bigger part in the show?
Oh, I liked it, of course.
Yeah.
Listen, I just did a one-woman show. I mean, I've done it a few times, but I wrote this one-woman show, and there are 8 characters. I play them all. They're all different ages.
I want to see this. I want
to
see this.
I do like to have a... Well, the next time I do it, I'll let you know.
All right.
I just finished it last week. I just did a 7-week run. So,
wow.
Yeah, so I do like... I like a lot of lines.
Right.
But so, yeah, it was fun. It was so much fun to do that show. It was great. So, you know, I was happy to have a small part or any part at all in it because, you know, David is so, he so much listens to everybody and everything. And if you make even the smallest, you know, remark, he really will hear it and act on it lots of times. And, you know, about a scene or reality. And he's just so creative and so open to collaboration or to input. It's fantastic, you know.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
My favorite scene that you were in Twin Peaks was, you know, Eileen goes to Ben's office at the Great Northern and is giving back the love letters. And there's this whole kind of going back and forth where like, oh, Ben loves you. But there's these emotions and like, you're kind of like, it seemed like you're like, oh, that's really sweet, but like, get away from me.
Yeah, you're ruining my life.
Yeah. I think that's kind of the way it was.
Yeah.
I think it was like a, well, come on, you know.
Right.
I mean, he was a...
Slime ball.
Yeah.
Slime ball.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I'll go for that. Yeah. I mean, you know, as a person, he's fine, but as a character, not so good.
Right.
You know, the idea of the small town and all the things that people know about each other. And, you know, I love that. All the dark underbelly of something, you know, that has that you saw the secrets, I guess, the layers and layers of secrets.
Rewatching this, I realized what was interesting as a story was, you know, in the beginning of the whole Hayward family and the pilot, it's all about trust. You know, Doc Hayward trusts his daughter and she snuck out of the house. But there's this whole trust. And by the end of the series, at the end of season two, you have the mother who is not being honest or trustworthy. And I thought that was an interesting kind of, full circle. I thought that was really, I really liked it.
I know. Well, I think that's always true, isn't it? I mean, you know, in a way, I don't know, when you say that, I hadn't thought about it exactly that way again. But I think, you know, it's almost like a child growing up where, at the, you know, when they're small, they, you know, look at their parents and they are sort of, you know, the absolute authority. And then, you know, you sort of think about your parents in one way. And then no matter what your parents, no matter what the story is, it's different as you get older and you realize, oh, they're human beings and they have their whole lives and secrets and, you know, or not even necessarily secrets, but just things you didn't realize or struggles that you didn't know because you're a child. And that's not, you shouldn't know that really, you know, you shouldn't know that how much they're maybe struggling or depressed or whatever. And then you usually come to terms that, you know, as you grow up at some point and then you see them as human, full human beings and, you know, then you can have a sort of very different relationship. So that's almost what happens, I guess, for the viewer, maybe that, you know, they, you see, you know, on one point of view, it's seeing, you know, she's the, you know, kind of child. And then you see, oh no. And the parents seem to be as from a child's point of view, like, you know, they're just perfect people or not perfect, but, you know, they kind of are just trustworthy and honest and all of that. And then you find out this whole other part.
Yeah.
And for the most of the scenes you were in with Laura Flynn Boyle, Warren Frost, and Richard Beamer, what was it like acting with these people?
I guess I just fully believed that I was Eileen Hayward and she was my daughter. And, you know, I fully was in it. You know, like I didn't have any problem. I don't even think of it as like actors acting or something. I just thought I was in that world and that's who I was.
Yeah.
And they were who they were. And I felt most of it was a pleasure. I can't remember any problems with other actors or directors.
Yeah.
You know, and it was nice because, you know, you had a lot of different directors come in and most of them were film directors, I think. Unfortunately,
right.
My husband and I never actually worked together because after the pilot, we went, you know, to see the screening and we saw David and David said, oh, do you want to direct one of them? You know, because he never thought it would be made into a TV series.
Right.
I mean, when we were doing the pilot, it was just a goof, kind of. Now, I don't mean that he didn't take it seriously.
I mean
a goof in the sense that, you know, we're doing this thing, but, I mean, it's never going to go on television. You know, it was like, it was so unusual and groundbreaking. And, you know, he would, you know, so that was the feeling during the pilot. And then, so when they showed the pilot, Caleb said, oh, it's, you know, David, it's great. And as I said, classmates it or whatever you would call it at the AFI. So they certainly had a lot of respect for each other. And Dave said, oh, you want to direct? And Caleb said, yeah. And then, you know, somehow it always worked out that I wasn't in any of the ones that Caleb directed. So, you know, we never did get to work together.
Oh, that's too funny.
So David said, oh, really? You know, it's just a funny little thing. But yeah. But the directors were all really great, and it was nice to have very different points of view. And I just felt like there was, I'm sure that just the tone was set by David, that there was a kind of respect everyone had for each other.
From your husband, did you learn anything about the production of the show? Like, he actually was kind of having to keep secrets of who killed Laura Palmer. I mean,
In fact, what was it? I'm trying to remember. Oh, we had this funny thing because, we're all the time because we get the script, you know, like there were all these fake scripts and only one, you know, because it was so exciting after every episode, you know, people talked about it everywhere you went. You would hear everyone was so into the show and, you know, just riveted. So it was really great to be a part of it. But yeah, I did. I certainly knew everything that was going on. That I could know that. Also, you know, Caleb has a lot of stories about, you know, he would come up with ideas all the time. And, you know, David would always say, yeah, go for it. Like,
that's
whatever
awesome.
It was, you know.
Yeah.
It was so much fun.
That's so cool. And so you actually got to attend the Twin Peaks, Missing Pieces premiere party kind of thing. And I wondered what you thought how that was. And you also, you would get to see your...
Yeah, fascinating to see that. Like, Because there were scenes that, you know, you'd forgotten about that had been cut out.
Yeah.
Like, there were some muffins. Or
yeah, you're giving muffins to Laura and Donna.
Yeah, I was baking muffins. No, it was actually really fascinating because there was something, you know, the sort of elliptical quality of that.
Yeah.
It just had a, I don't know, it's just sort of like an art piece or something, you know,
where
you could fill in something. It's hard to explain, but I really enjoyed it. I don't know. I mean, it was a while ago, so I just remember having this kind of amazing feeling that it sort of made sense in a funny way.
David did a great job editing that. It almost felt like its own film in a way. Like, I don't know how he was able to do that.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It's like, it is. And I think, you know, when someone, it's like someone's vision or voice or whatever, when, you know, people are very consistent and they kind of know what that is. No matter what they do, it's always going to have a certain coherence to it. And you can't almost take anything away from what he does, no matter what you take out and how, even if it's in pieces, it makes some kind of sense.
Yeah.
And it's true. I mean, his editing, I mean, certainly great talent.
Helps.
I mean, he has a vision, but he also has this great talent.
And so how did you find out that Twin Peaks was coming back? I mean, and did you happen to watch it when it came back?
I watched part of it. I haven't seen everything.
Sure.
I don't know how I found out. I think I might have been just like, you know, reading about it, or, you know, like I didn't get an official announcement or anything.
Yeah.
I think we just heard, you know, you just read about it.
Sure.
Yeah.
It's still kind of crazy to think 25 years later the show came back. I mean, it still kind of boggles the mind.
It's great.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it really was an amazing show because it just, I don't think people realize, I mean, you do because you're such devotees or whatever of it, but it just really was groundbreaking when it came out. And you felt like things were possible that you never thought could be possible in a sort of creative way. I mean, they certainly broke all these rules in terms of getting around censorship and all of that, which is pretty cool. They were always figuring that out, you know, and they had a lot of fun. But then there was this, openness and a creative part that was just opened up so many possibilities that just weren't there before. So
definitely,
it is amazing to come back after 25 years, but I sort of think, yes, of course, it should have never gone away. It was only two seasons, but it was hard. You know, I think just that it was kind of difficult to keep the quality up and, you know, that they wanted to have, really.
Yeah,
definitely.
There's one big story in terms of, like, David being open to, you know, and, well, we were doing, it was right, you know, and after the big sort of, what was it? It was a beauty contest. And
Twin Peaks.
Miss Twin Peaks. Sorry, I haven't re-watched everything, so I have everything so clear in my mind.
Sure, totally understand that.
So anyway, it was the next morning. It was a scene the next morning. And, you know, I went and I'm thinking, well, we would be, because it was like everybody was up really late and all these things happened and it was, you know, traumatic night, like you're up all night. Mm. And I thought we would be in the kind of like in the same clothes from the night before and, you know, your hair, kind of that feeling. And I thought that's what I was thinking when I went in, you know, drove into the set. And then when I went in and, you know, to makeup and hair, and I said, oh, I thought we were going to do this. And I said, oh, no, we're not, you know, this is what we're doing. No, new day, blah, blah, blah. So I get the makeup, we have the wardrobe, get my hair, and then we go to have a group, you know, a group rehearsal. And I said to David, and everybody's ready. You know, everyone spent the 2 hours or whatever getting ready, and everyone's ready except for the final thing. And I said, oh, I'm surprised. I thought we would be like, you know, in the stuff from the night before and it'd be like that. And David said, he just looked at me and said, oh, okay. And then everybody is like, and that's what I mean. He would just like, you just say a comment like, oh, I thought this. And he'd go, oh, that's a good idea. And, you know, in television, you don't usually, first of all, no one's listening to you that much. Or the power, you just certainly don't have that power. And even if you wanted to, you would not take the time to do that.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, it cost them a lot of time. I mean, obviously, everybody had to go complete. I mean, everybody was in that scene, and, you know, so that to me was just, that's David.
It's great that he's so open to that.
That's really cool. I like that story a lot.
Yeah. So that's my story.
And I think you've shared a story.
I'm sticking to it.
I think you shared something with Brad Dukes about Reflections, but something about David ripping up a script or something like that.
Oh, yeah. Yes. He also did that. I'll never forget. That was on the pilot.
Why did he do that?
Well, this is what they said. We don't have time. You know, sort of like you're over budget, over time. You know, you don't have time to do this scene. Or like we're like, someone came up and I was standing there. David just took the script and didn't look at it. He ripped out a few pages and he goes, okay, there you go. And he really stuck to it. I mean, it wasn't like he went back and, you know, it wasn't just a display of, you know.
Wow.
No, I mean, and I thought, oh, that is fantastic. You
know? Wow.
It's kind of like, you know, the ways they tried to figure out who the killers were and all that stuff, you know.
Yeah.
It's like,
That's so cool.
Using your intuition. Yeah. So anyway, yes, he did tear out a lot of pages.
Nice.
That's so cool.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much
for your time. Okay. I'm so glad we got to talk to you.
Yeah, it was really fun. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Take care.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Mary Jo Deschanel. It was so awesome to get to talk to you. And, you know, I love all of her stories. I love stories about back in the day that people got together and they couldn't really afford to go to restaurants and they just would get together at people's houses and have dinners and socialize. And that's one of the places that she saw David Lynch and stuff. And I thought that was a cool story.
Oh, yeah. And also hearing about her practicing in the wheelchair, getting the part, and like, yeah, she had such awesome little nuggets about her career, and she's just a wonderful person, and it was just an honor to talk to her.
It really was. It was so cool. So, so that was a sample of really one of our interviews. In our book, it's not like we just plop the interview. It's really, she's, a lot of times it has to do with the episode that we're talking about, or she's, sometimes the people doing interviews are almost responding to other people, which is really kind of cool.
And before we get going, Ben, I do want to thank everybody that has posted photos of them getting our book on social media. That means the world to us. Thank you so much. The love from the community was overwhelming. I still can't believe we put a book out, but then on top of it, I still can't believe people are posting photos with our book across the globe.
Which it makes my day. It really does make my day. Every day that I see somebody post that is just like, I don't know, people think, oh, they don't want to see the book again, but we do. We just, it makes our day to see people in people's hands, on people's desks. Was it Aaron? I think his cat had his own book.
Yeah, so cool. And one special shout out goes to our friends from Sparkwood and 21, M, which was very sweet of her. She like wrote us an actual congratulations card
and mailed it to
us. Yeah, like
individually, we both got one. I think you got yours first and said, like, "Hey, M sent me a card," and then I looked in my mailbox and sure enough, I got one too. And that was so touching. I mean, she's so cool.
Yeah, people don't do that anymore. I mean, the last time I sent like an actual physical card was probably like from my wedding or something like that, but it's not something you do generally. And it meant a lot to us. So thank you, Em. Like, that was so cool to get a physical card from somebody is just something that doesn't happen very often. And you know, it's weird. We're in a situation now where we would say social media or, you know, technology is disconnecting us because we're on it too much, but now we're using it to connect with each other.
Isn't that true? Isn't that something?
Yeah, it's weird to think that now technology is bringing us together because we can't physically be together. That's a wonderful thing. I guess everybody could, if you want to get yourself a copy of the book, bluerosemag.com, send us an email at twinpeaksunwrapped@gmail.com. Ben, he's always on Twitter. How's Twitter going? I haven't asked you in a long time.
How is Twitter going? It's wonderful. I mean, that's where you get to see all our friends, and it's going really well.
Right. And Facebook, I take care of our Facebook page, and it's growing. Like, we're getting new followers and likes, like, all the time. And everyone seems really, like, I try to engage. I'm not really on social media that much, but I try to do my best with our Facebook page. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Give us a 5-star review. We're on Spotify. We're all on those wonderful podcast places. And we're on KAST.
Yeah, how do people find your KAST?
How do people find us on KAST?
I will share a direct link in the show notes for KAST. So that will be, you click on that, you'll be able to figure out if you want to go through a browser and participate, or if you want to download the app. There's a phone app, there's a desktop app, and you'll have the link to get in, and you can just request an invite. It is a private, we set it to be a private party. So it's kind of like you have to be invited, but we invite everybody. And it's every Friday, I think, we're going to be doing this. So not only are we going to be showing episodes, but we'll also have deleted scenes and commercials, and it'll just be a good old time just to hang out and chat with each other about Twin Peaks.
With all that, Ben, we will see everybody stay healthy, stay safe, stay inside, wash those hands, and
be like Harold.
Yes, be like Harold, and we'll be back when we're back.